This is an actual Windows computer. These are both Windows computers. You see how ridiculous this is? This is the Pantera Pico PC, and it's supposedly good for day-to-day stuff, you know, day-to-day common Windows stuff, and maybe even just a little bit of retro gaming. Hey guys, Ash here from C4E Tech, and today let's justify the tech part of C4E Tech by taking a look at something that's not a smartphone. With this kind of weight, it's actually easy to just throw in your pocket and walk off with. I love how the maker XDO has provided a lot of IO on this one. In a day and age where it's Type-C and done, we have three USB 3 ports, two to the front along with a micro SD card slot, one to the back with a USB 2 port, 3.5mm jack, and Type-C for power and an HDMI out. For a little bit of pizzazz, XDO's thrown in a blue LED to the top, and it looks quite nice. Now, there are some super cool accessories that they sell along with this, which kind of makes it a standalone computer, an actual Windows PC that you can use with no cables. But we'll get to all that in a moment. I mean, if you wanna actually check it out in detail, I'll leave a link to their Indiegogo in the description. But before all that, let's first start with the actual specs. We've got an Intel Celeron J4125 on the inside, 4 cores, 4 threads, clocked at up to 2.7 GHz. Well, all that sounds nice, this happens to be one of the least powerful Intel chips in the market. But there is a but, which we'll get to in a minute. This chip is paired with 8 gigs of DDR4 RAM that's running at 2133 MHz and up to 1 terabyte of M.2 storage. Mine has 256, by the way. So here's the thing. The low power chip inside lets this be powered via a 12 volt power bank. It's definitely not something you're gonna be buying for gaming, even light gaming for that matter. But if you're someone looking for a super small PC for day-to-day use, you know, for docs or Word, Excel or Sheets, a presentation here, a PDF there for browsing, it feels good enough for all that. I had no issues. Next up, I tried 4K video playback because I'm sure that's gonna be another major use case scenario for this. Watching Netflix or Amazon Prime or YouTube, and the playback here was good. If you look at the stats, it dropped about 17 frames right at the start when it was loading, but after that, throughout the video, it did not drop another frame. So if it's video playback that you're looking at, it's smooth up to 4K. So that's basically your low power day-to-day use. But at this point, I was also curious, what can this hardware do? I mean, I get it can push up to 4K for regular tasks and even media consumption, but could you game on it? I mean, let's say it's just light gaming. I was just curious about that. So to satisfy my curiosity, I started with a title that's very easy to run, Rise of Nations Extended Edition. On low graphics at 720p, I was able to hit a smooth 60 FPS. As you can see, the game feels very playable. Given the frame rate, I personally wouldn't actually mind playing Rise of Nations on this. Next, I switched to my favorite game at the moment, Dead Cells. If you've not tried this, please do. It's amazing. This is available on Android too. I have close to 80 hours on my Switch, and it runs flawlessly here on the Pantera. Now, if all this made you think, even for just a single moment, can this run any AAA titles at low graphics or something? Remove thought from mind, because nope, most AAA titles don't even get past the boot screen or get to the boot screen. And even if they do, the frame rates are abysmal. But then again, I'm not gonna blame him for it, because like I said, this is not meant to play games. But that doesn't mean I'm not gonna test emulation. Of course, I'm gonna. NES, Genesis, the Game Boys, we know pretty much anything that runs Windows can run it. So let's start with something a little harder, Nintendo 64. Here I'm trying Mario Kart 64. There seems to be some issue with going full screen because every time I do, it causes a crash. Hence, I'm running it windowed. There's probably a fix for it, but hey, that's not the point here. The performance is smooth, frame rate stable. Nintendo 64 is definitely playable here. It's actually a good experience. Next, let's crank it up with the next Nintendo console, the GameCube. Here's one of my favorite titles on it, Super Mario Sunshine. It seems to run smoothly. I mean, it's a stable 30 FPS. Of course, there's the occasional dip. Do note that this is 30 FPS without any graphical enhancement. So it's native GameCube resolution, 528p, no anti-aliasing, nothing extra. It's just as is. Now let's check out some Legend of Zelda Twilight Princess. Again, the results seem very similar. I've not added anything extra to the native GameCube stuff. With this, we are able to hit that 30 FPS playable mark. So this leads me to believe GameCube is gonna be playable here, as long as you're not looking for any of the graphical frills that you get with emulation. Okay, what about the other Nintendo console? You know, maybe, just maybe, we can get a little bit of Switch out of this? Not really. Doesn't seem possible. With Super Mario Odyssey, we are hitting 10 to 15 FPS. That's definitely not playable. But then my next thought was, maybe with something easier. But no, I decided to try a couple of other titles and the results were worse. So let's move on to another console, PS2. Start with something intense, God of War 2. And the speed's low, frame drops all over.
Kratos, the once mortal lord,
this is unplayable. Which led me to the next logical question, what about titles that are not quite as intense? Contra, Shattered Soldier, for example. With that, the game's playable, not optimal, 40-ish FPS. With GameCube, it was 30 FPS, but that was better because the speed was 100%. It was a game locked to 30 FPS, so the gameplay actually felt stable. Not the case here though, the speed dips and it's pretty difficult to play. So for all intents and purposes, we've ruled out PS2 and the Switch, which also means others like Wii or Wii U are not gonna be playable. The fact that GameCube runs leads us to conclude that PS1 or PSP should be good. With the game tests out of the way, let's now turn our attention to the accessories. First, we have this foldable keyboard, which is nice. It's compact. It pairs via Bluetooth. The battery life seems to be good. My biggest pet peeve with this would have to be those arrow keys. I mean, yes, Apple does it, but I feel they're criminal. Then there's this vertical mouse. Of course, there's a USB hub if you want, and a solid carry case if you want to throw it into your backpack or something. Then we have this projector. It's definitely a high point of this PC. It's got a battery built in, it's got Android on it, so you can technically use it without this at all. You don't need to be running Windows. You can just use it as a standalone Android device onto the projector, just stream videos and whatnot. It's got a functional remote and its own carry case. But that's not what we are going to be looking at today. So let's go ahead, choose HDMI, and pretty much whatever's plugged in, you get to see that on the big screen. This projector has auto keystone correction, so the aspect ratio is maintained. You don't really have to tinker around with stuff. It's decently bright, and hey, I actually don't have the wall space to show you how large it can get. But you get an idea from this. Do note that the speaker here is absolute trash. I mean, when you accidentally play something on your phone and you have your earphones plugged in and you wonder, hey, I can hear something playing somewhere. Well, what you hear coming from your earphones is probably louder and clearer than what this has to offer. So it's that bad. Any which ways, there's a 12-volt power bank that should make this entire setup standalone at a high level of portability. So I felt this was nuts. We have PCs being shrunk to this size. So if you feel this idea is interesting too, go ahead, check out their Indiegogo campaign from the description below, the link in the description below. And oh wait, if you're wondering why is he not talking about price, is he tackying this? Well, not really. I don't have the information yet. Once I do, I'll pin it in the comments below, or you should be able to find it once it goes live on the Indiegogo page. So what do you guys think of this? I have a few more, not quite as small, but super powerful PC videos, mini PC videos coming up. So don't miss out on it. Subscribe if you haven't yet. And I want to know what you guys feel about this video. So thumbs up, thumbs down based on your thoughts. And thanks for your time. Thanks for watching. Until next time, my name's Ash. You've been watching C4 Retech. And I'm signing off for now. You guys have a great day. Bye-bye.